Hi guys, my name is Jameel Ahmed, and as you know that we were discussing about the general principles of the pharmacology. First chapter was about the pharmacokinetics, and now we will discuss about the pharmacodynamics. What is the pharmacodynamics? In this lecture, we will see some general definitions of some general concepts, so that we will be able to start the pharmacodynamics pharmacodynamics chapter. So first, we must know about these terms: agonistics, antagonistics, affinity, potency, and efficacy. Some terms are used in this chapter that are very important. We must know about these terms. Okay, so now we will start. The first is the pharmacodynamics. As you know that pharmaco means that drug. So pharmaco means that drug. So it means drug. And if you talk about the dynamics, and dynamics mean that the power. So dynamic means that the power. So what does mean pharmacodynamics? Pharmacodynamics means that power of drug. So according to its meaning, power of drug means that what is the power of drug? Means that what drug does to the body. Drug will show its power to body. So definition is the what the drug does to the body. So now drug will show its power to body. In pharmacokinetics, what the body does to the drug means that body was showing some effects on the drug, that what the body does to the drug. Now, drug will show its power. It will show some effects onto the body. So now we will call this pharmacodynamics. As you can see that, how the drug affects the body, that is the drug we have taken, administered. Drug will go and it will bind to the receptors and will show their effects. Okay? Let's suppose that this is a cell. And you know that every cell, maybe any cell, any tissue, liver tissue, stomach tissue, any tissue. Let's suppose that this is a cell. So, cell of any tissue. So, it has receptors on it. So, every cell has receptors. So, it has receptors. Then the drug will come. So, we have taken the drug. The drug will come and it will come and will bind with the receptors. So, drug will bind with the receptor. When drug will bind with the receptors, and after that, this drug will show its effect on this cell. So, drug will show its effect on the cell, that is called the pharmacodynamics. So these effects may be the positive effects, beneficial effects, maybe the negative effects, harmful effects. So both kind of effects may be beneficial effects or harmful effects. So what is the definition of pharmacodynamics? What the drug does to the body means the drug will bind to the receptors and show their effects, that is called the pharmacodynamics. So this is the proper definition of pharmacodynamics. Now we will discuss about some terms used in pharmacodynamics. First is the agonist. What is the agonist? Basically, agonist is nothing. This is a drug. Agonist is a drug. Agonist is a drug that will go and binds to the receptors. Same like that, it will go and binds to the receptors, and in result, it will show its response. It will show its effects, and these effects may be the positive effects or negative effects. That drug named agonist drug. So drug that will go and will bind with the receptor and will show its response, will show its effect, and will give its effects, that is called the agonist drug. So agonist drug has further types, little bit. We can say that these are the types, that full agonist, partial agonist, and inverse agonist. What are these? Full agonist. Full agonist says that when the drug will go and drug will bind with the receptor and then will go with the maximum response. It means that if this is a cell, drug will come, it will bind with the receptor, and it will give its response 100%. It will give its effects, maybe the positive effects or negative effects, but it will give its effects 100%. And if it gives its 100% effects, maximum response, maximum efficacy, means that maximum effectiveness, 100% response, then that drug named as the full agonistic. Means that this drug is giving its full response. That drug will named as the full agonistic. Normally, when we use the word agonist, then it means that this is the full agonist. Okay, so if we use the word agonist, it also means that this is the full agonist. Next term used as the partial agonist. So partial agonist is incapable of maximum response. Full agonist was giving its maximum response, but now this time it will not give its maximum response. So let's suppose that this is a cell. Again, drug will come, it will bind with the receptors, and it will stimulate these receptors. Basically, it will affect the cell by stimulating the receptors and will show its effects. drug, commonly drug, what happens? Drug will come, will bind with the receptors and will stimulate these receptors and will show its effects. But in this case, when drug will come, will bind with the receptors, then it will not stimulate the receptors properly. When receptors will not stimulate properly, then they will not give their proper response. They will not give their maximum response. They will give their less response. Less than 100%, not 100%. This time, not 100%, less than 100%. So, incapable of maximum response are less efficient than full agonistic. You know that full agonistic was giving 100% response, and partial agonist will not give us 100% response. It will give less than 100% response. Therefore, it is called the partial agonist. Partial, you know that partial means that not complete, partially. Next term is the inverse agonist. So, inverse agonist says that the drugs which will change the active receptors into inactive receptors or stabilize the inactive receptors. I think this is still non-noticeable for you. Commonly what happens? Normally happens that this is a cell and these are the receptors. Maybe the on the cell surface receptors, maybe the intracellular receptor. Let's suppose that it's the cell surface receptors. So this is a receptor. Normally this receptor is inactive. When there is a no drug, when there is a no drug bind to the receptor, then this is an inactive. And when drug will come and drug will bind with this receptor, now it is active. So now this receptor will become active and it will be stimulated and it will show its effects. This is the normal. But sometimes, this is a cell, these are the receptors which are inactive. But sometimes these receptors become active without binding to drug. Means the drug will not come and will not bind with the receptors, but receptors will become active spontaneously. Okay, now these receptors are active without any drug. There is a no drug, but receptors are active. Then what is the function of agonist? Then we will give the drug. This drug will go and this drug will change this active receptors to normal back to inactive receptors. Okay, so now this will be changed into normal receptors. What is the concept? The concept is this, that when simply there is a cell and cell have receptors, these receptors are inactive. When drug will come and drug will bind with these receptors, then these receptors will become active. But sometimes these receptors become active without any drug. Spontaneously they become active and we have to put them inactive. Then we will give the inverse agonist. The inverse agonist will go and they will change the active receptors into inactive receptors into their normal form. So this is that drugs change the active receptors to inactive receptors or stabilize the inactive receptors. So mean that it will stabilize the inactive receptors. First inactive receptors, then it will change the active to inactive receptors and stable the inactive receptors. So this is called the inverse agonist. Next term used as the antagonist. If you have understood the concept agonist, then you will understand the concept antagonist. So what is antagonist? Antagonist, what was the agonist? Agonist was the drug that binds the receptors and shows us response. Remember that word. But in case of antagonist, same. Antagonist is also a drug. So this is also a drug. It will go and it will bind with the receptor, but it will not show the response. It will not show the response. Agonist was the drug that was binding to the receptor and was showing their response. But now, this will go, it will bind with the receptor, but it will not give its response. Rather, it will go and it will prevent the antagonist to bind the receptors. So, mean that it is preventing the response. Agonist will bind to the receptor and showing its response. But now, let's suppose that this is a receptor, this is a cell and it has a receptor. So, let's suppose that it is a cell and it has a receptor. Then, what is the function of, normally the agonist will come, normally the agonist will come, it will bind with this receptor and will show its response. So, the response will be shown. But what is the function of antagonist drug? We will give the antagonist drug. The antagonist drug will come and it will bind with the receptor. So, now antagonist drug will bind with the receptor. And now, when agonist drug will come, then agonist drug will not bind with the receptors. Then it will not bind with the receptor, then there is a no response. So basically, it prevents the agonist to bind the receptors. When agonist will not bind the receptors, then it will prevent the response. So there will be the no response. There are a little bit, you can say that there are some terms used in antagonists, some classification. That is the pharmacological antagonist, physiological antagonist, and chemical antagonist. Mean that how these drugs prevent the response in different mechanisms. These mechanisms are the pharmacological antagonists, physiological antagonists, and chemical antagonists. Mean that this antagonist use different ways to stop the action of agonist, right? So now moves on. So now we first will see the pharmacological antagonists. Pharmacological antagonists have the same receptors. Let's suppose that I will draw the agonist with the green one, and I will draw the antagonist with the red one. Okay, so this is the antagonist and this is the agonist. So now both have the same receptors, same like that. Both have the same receptors. I will explain this once again. Both have the same receptors. So let's suppose that this is a cell. It has the receptors, and both agonist and antagonist has same receptor. Okay. So now they have the same receptor, but further two types. Maybe the competitive antagonism or maybe the non-competitive antagonism. When we talk about the competitive antagonism, then in case of competitive antagonism, then this competition of agonist with antagonist. Ionic bond. But how? So now, first, let's suppose that antagonism comes and binds with the receptor, but this bond is the ionic bond, weak bond. Now there is a competition, then comes the antagonism, it also has the ionic bond. So if agonist binds with the receptor, then it will show its effects, it will give the response. And if antagonism wins and it binds with the receptor, then it will stop the response. Antagonism will win. If this will bind with this one, and agonist will win, and it will show its response. So this is the concept, that they have a competition with each other, ionic bond, because ionic bond, they are in competition with each other. So if we increase the concentration of agonist, then greater the concentration of agonist means that more bond between agonist and receptors, so it will show its effects. And if we increase the concentration of antagonist, so no, and more antagonist means that more bond between receptors and antagonist, so it will stop the response. So no, it will win. So therefore, this line is saying that greater the concentration, change the state. If we greater the concentration of agonist, then it will change the state towards agonist. Agonist will show its response. If we greater the concentration of antagonist, then it will stop the response. No, antagonist will win. So this is the concept. Next is the non-competitive antagonism. There is no competition. Same receptor, but no competition. Why? Because in this case, what was happening? In this case, if there is a cell and this cell has a receptor, and on this receptor there is an antagonism and agonist and antagonist. Antagonist have ionic bond, but this time this antagonist has the strong covalent bond. When this one has the covalent bond, antagonist will come and it will bind with the receptor by covalently. Now this is a permanent bond. One time it will come and it will form the bond, so no breakage of bond. So this is a covalent and permanent bond. So now if we increase the concentration of the agonist, then there is a no change, because there is a no breakage of this bond. We are increasing the concentration of antagonist more, but there is a no change in the form. Why? Because first we have to break this bond, and again, then it will bind with this other, with this receptor. But this bond is very, very strong, covalent bond, permanent bond. This bond will not break. So either we are increasing how much amount of the agonist, it doesn't change the state. So therefore it says that this is the irreversible antagonist. It will not come back towards the agonist. This is the permanent covalent bond, and greater the concentration, no change in the state. So it was about the same receptors. If agonist and antagonist, both drugs have the same receptors, this is the concept behind that. Next is the physiological antagonist. Physiological antagonists have different receptors. Different receptors how? Mean that drug 1, that is the agonist, have its own receptor, and drug 2, that is the antagonistic, has its own receptors. Okay, they have different receptors, but interacts to each other effects. So now let's suppose that drug 1 is the agonist. Drug 1 is the agonist, and it's showing its response. It's giving its response. Okay, so now we will give the drug 2, that is the antagonist. So now this antagonist will go and will act on the receptor 2 and the receptor. When it will act on the receptor, then it's showing its own action. It's showing its own action. But action of antagonist will interact the action of agonist and will stop its response. That is called the physiological antagonism. Okay. I will explain in the form of figure. Let's suppose that this is a cell. Okay. So this is the one receptor one. This is the receptor two. Let's suppose that this is the antagonism. Agonist drug comes and acts on the receptors and shows its response. And there is an antagonism. Antagonist will show its response on R2. So it is showing its response normally. When this will come and will act on receptor 2, now it will show its action and interacts with this mechanism and will stop this mechanism. So in this way, it will stop the action of response of agonist, that is called the physiological antagonist. Okay. The example is the vasocontractor and vasodilator. You know that which drug is the vasocontractor? The drug named as the, remember that, phenylephrine. Let's suppose that phenylephrine is a drug. Let's suppose that this is the agonist drug, and it is acting on the R1 receptors, that are receptors on the vessels, and cause the constriction of the vessels. When vessels are contracted, then it increase the BP, increase the blood pressure. So what is the concept? The concept is that, let's suppose that phenylephrine is an agonist drug. It will go and acts on the receptor 1 of the vessels and cause increase of the blood pressure. So now we will give the another drug, that is the antagonist. So now we will give the antagonist drug. Let's suppose that the antagonist drug is the nitroglycerin. So nitroglycerin. So what is the function of nitroglycerin? Decrease the blood pressure. So it will go and it will act on the another receptor. Why? Because different receptor. And it will cause the decrease blood pressure. But how it is causing the vasodilator? This is the vasodilator. It causes the dilation of the vessels. So this is a concept in physiological antagonism. Means that phenylephrine is acting on receptor 1 and increasing BP by vasoconstriction. Now antagonist, that is the nitroglycerin, will come and act on the R2 receptors and the receptor and decrease the blood pressure by causing the vasodilator. So both have different receptors, both have different response, but they are interacts with each other and interacts their actions. As like the nitroglycerin interacts the action of phenylephrine. Phenylephrine increases the BP, but nitroglycerin affects its action by decreasing BP, but acts at different receptors. Next is the chemical antagonist. Chemical antagonist is different from both of these. In this case, there is no receptor involved. We didn't need any kind of receptor. No need of receptors. There is a drug interacts with each other. If we give the one drug, it's showing its action, then we'll give the another drug, drug 2. These drugs will act with each other. No involvement of the receptors. These drugs which act each other and they will interact with each other and they will interact with their effects. Let's suppose that protamine, we are taking the heparin, a drug. We are taking the heparin and we want that heparin effects must not show. We want to neutralize the effect of heparin. Then we will give the another drug that named as the protamine. So when we give the protamine drug will affect with the heparin directly, with the organic receptor. So it will act with the, react with the heparin and it will neutralize its action. It will neutralize its response. That is called the chemical antagonist. So these were terms about agonist and antagonist. So next three terms that is also important, that is the affinity, potency and efficacy. So what is the affinity? Affinity is the ability of drug to bind to receptors. That affinity is the ability of drug to bind to receptors. Means that how well drug bind to receptors. That is called the affinity. Okay. Next is the nearer the curve to y-axis, greater the affinity. So if you talk about the graph, let's suppose that this is the graph and there is a two curves. Let's suppose that there are two curves. And curve 1 is for drug 1 and drug 2. So we are comparing two drugs, drug 1 and drug 2. And we are saying that which drug has greater affinity. What is the affinity? Ability of drug to bind the receptors. Mean that which drug binds to receptors more properly. We will determine this by measuring the concentration of drug. measuring the concentration of drug that binds to 50% receptors. Okay, that the concentration of drug that binds to 50% receptor, that is called affinity of that drug. Concentration of drug that binds to 50% receptors is the affinity of that drug. So now we will compare both of drug 1 and drug 2. Also, this is for drug 1 and this is for drug 2. So, this one is the concentration of drug that binds to 50% of receptors, and for D2, same concentration of drug responds to 50%. If there is a less concentration for D1, mean the drug 1 has less concentration that binds to 50% drugs more properly, where it has less concentration and binding to receptor is greater, but this one has greater concentration but binding to 50% receptors, then which has the greater affinity? Which has the greater ability? This one, which has a decreased concentration. But why? You know that we are giving more concentration that is binding to 50% receptors, and same amount and the drug that has the less amount and binding to the 50% receptors. Mean that these are same and drug's amount is less for D1. When D1 is less, mean that D1 has greater ability to bind to receptors. We don't have to increase the concentration. Less amount is enough to bind to the receptors. It means that this is a greater ability. If this is difficult for you to remember, then you can remember that nearer the curve to y-axis, greater the affinity. So D1, D2, which curve is nearer to y-axis? This is the y-axis and this is the i-axis. This curve is nearer to y-axis, means that this curve has the greater the affinity. Okay, this was the concern. Second is the limitation. Limitation talked about that curves must be parallel. These curves must be parallel. Same like that. You can see that these both are parallel. These are going in this way and this is also going this way. So these are parallel. To compare the drug's affinity, two curves must be parallel in a graph. That's important. It's about its limitation. So it talks about inverse to KD. Same like that. We are talking here that if drug 1 has less concentration but it has greater affinity. Okay. So drug 2 has greater concentration but it has less affinity. Same like that KD. KD is the concentration of drug that binds to 50% receptors. So if concentration of drug is less, which is binding to 50% receptor, that has the greater affinity. If concentration of drug is greater, then the affinity will be less. Inverse to each other. Same like that kinetic mechanisms. Mean that if a small amount of enzymes showing its effects 50% and greater amount of enzymes are showing its effect 50%, the enzymes which are less, that have the greater affinity. Same like that kinetic mechanisms. Second is the potency. What is the potency? Potency says that the concentration of drug to achieve a desired effect. Same concept, 50% effect. So, let's suppose that if we have a drug 1 and it's showing its 50% response, and drug 2 it's showing its 50% response also. Response is same, but drug 1 is less in amount and drug 2 is greater in amount. So, drug 1 is less any mode is showing 50% effect, mean that it has the greater potency. It has the greater potency. Less amount of drug is showing 50% response, mean that it has the greater potency. And greater amount of drug 2 is showing the same response, mean that if drug is more, mean that its potency is less. We need more drug to show the 50% response. It means that its potency is less. It is less potent. And drug 1 need less concentration to show the 50% response. Response is same, but depends upon the concentration. If concentration is less, potency is greater. If concentration is greater, potency is low. Same like that affinity. And we can say again, nearer to the curve to the y-axis, greater will be the potency. Same like that affinity. But here is a greater the potency. But here the limitation is that curves must not cross each other. Same like that. These are crossing each other? No. This is going up. Increase how much? These will not cross to each other. But if, let's suppose that this is the curve and this is one and this is the one. So now if we increase up and this increase in this way, both of these will cross each other. If these curves cross each other, then we will not be able to compare the potency of two drugs. Next is the efficacy. That is the last one. Efficacy says that how well drug effects, it supports its effectiveness. Mean that if drug is effecting very well, then it has the greater efficacy. Simple. And greater the height of the gun, greater will be the efficacy. In this way, let's suppose that this is the two calves, and if we talk about these two calves, and these two calves, which one has greater height? This one has the greater height, this one has the lesser height. The drug which has the greater height, that has the greater efficacy, that is more effective. And limitations, there's no limitations in efficacy. We can compare these drugs. So it was little about the pharmacodynamics, little bit terms used in the pharmacodynamics. Next lecture, we will properly discuss about the dose response curves in a graph. So thank you so much. Yes.